Hi everyone, today as group 8 members will be presenting to you a presentation on measurement of radioactivity. Before we begin, let's listen or let's read through this wonderful quote by Marie Curie. A scientist in his laboratory is not a mere technician. He is also a child confronting natural phenomena that impress him as though they were fairy tales. Beautiful, right? Today we will be dealing with the topic of measurement of radioactivity. All members will be dealing with different topics related to this as we move forward in the presentation. My topic of discussion is radioactivity and principle of measuring radioactivity, and my name is Shweta Jairam. I hope you understand what this topic is all about after this. So what is radioactivity? It is simply elements losing particles from their nucleus and they release energy as they change. Now we know that an atom has a definite amount of protons and neutrons, which are the elements present in the nucleus. For example, sodium has 11 protons and 12 neutrons. Now when it loses some of its protons, sodium is not sodium anymore. That is what is written here. This atom loses some protons or neutrons, changing into another element, and radioactivity is a natural process. Radioactivity cannot be described without the two most important people, Henri Becquerel and Marie Curie. Henri Becquerel, the first person to discover the evidence of radioactivity through an accidental experiment. He found out that uranium was radioactive accidentally. And there is one more fun fact about him, that he is known for his general skill in laboratory techniques including photography. Now that is pretty interesting about him, right? Marie Curie, who is the first woman Nobel laureate also to win two Nobel Prizes in physics and chemistry. She is the pioneer in the study of radiation, coined the term radioactivity, and also discovered the elements radium and polonium. She is not just an amazing scientist, but also an inspiring personality to all women out there who broke stereotypes even at that point of time. Now, this is a normal question that can come to any of our mind. Why does radioactivity occur? Now we said radioactivity is all about losing elements, losing the particles from their nucleus. Now why would that happen? This is a very normal question. The main cause of this is an unstable nucleus. That is, if there is an excess of protons or excess of neutrons in nucleus, they tend to get rid of these protons and neutrons to actually become stable. Now this is quite understandable, right? Pretty simple. So, there are three types of radioactive decay, alpha, beta and gamma. I will not be going into detail about this because our topic of discussion is all about measurement of radioactivity. So, let's quickly jump on to our main topic, which is measurement of radioactivity. Now, radioactivity is measured in disintegrations per second, which could be Curie's per gram or Becquerel's per gram. Now, why do we have to measure radioactivity? So that it could be compared. Now if someone gives us two radionuclides and asks us which one is more radioactive than the other, only if we measure the radioactivity will we be able to reach a conclusion. And so that is why we are measuring radioactivity. The specific activity, which is actually a physical property of a radionuclide, which is inversely proportional to its atomic weight and its half-life. Now we move on to the principle of measurement. Now, the basic principle of why we are able to measure radioactivity is that these radiations are known to interact with substances. That is, if we allow the radiation to pass through a material medium, these radiations will interact with the particles of the medium, and thus we can measure radioactivity through this. That is what is written here. This radioactivity can be measured using the interaction between the radiation and the substances. There are many apparatus that we basically use for measuring radioactivity. Now all of these basically use this very same principle to measure radioactivity. So let us look at what are the specific principles of these particular apparatuses. One is the GM counter or the Geiger-Müller counter. This one utilizes the ionization between the radiation gas atoms. That is ionization takes place when the radiation passes through this. Second one is a scintillation counter. There are two types of them, liquid and sodium iodide. Both of these uses excitation of substances, that is, the material medium substances get excited and they emit light, because of which we're able to measure radiation. Now, both of these will be dealt with by my other group members in detail as to how they work, but this is the basic principle as to why these two apparatus are basically being used to measure this radiation. That was all about my topic. Now I pass on to Shruti S. Kamath of my group to help you understand more about units of measuring radioactivity. Thank you all.
Now the next topic is units of measuring radioactivity. I will be dealing with that. And my name is Shruti S. Kamath. So basically, there are three common units for measuring radioactivity. Which are they? They are Curie, Rutherford and Becquerel. Firstly, Curie. It is named after Marie Curie. How can we explain that? So, the activity of a given sample of radioactive substance is said to be 1 Curie if it has 3.7 into 10 raised to 10 disintegrations per second. What does that mean? This disintegration per second means the disintegration happening to the atoms or molecules that is present in the given sample. Curie has its smaller units like millicurie, microcurie, etc. So 1 millicurie is equal to 3.7 into 10 raised to 7 disintegration per second, and 1 microcurie is 3.7 into 10 raised to 4 disintegration per second. So next unit is Rutherford. It is named after Lord Ernest Rutherford. We all know that. So it can be defined as follows. The activity of a given sample of radioactive substance is 1 Rutherford if it has 10 raised to 6 disintegration per second. So just like Curie, it also has its smaller units like milli Rutherford, micro Rutherford, which is shown in the slide. 1 milli Rutherford is 10 raised to 3 disintegration per second, and 1 micro Rutherford is 1 disintegration per second. And finally, the most important unit, that is Becquerel. We all come up with this unit in solving problems. So Becquerel, it is the unit named after Antoine Henri Becquerel. The activity of a sample, of a given sample of radioactive substance is 1 Becquerel if it has 1 disintegration per second. Symbol. So 1 Becquerel equal to 1 disintegration per second. Other than these three important units, we have some not much important units like rad, gray, rem, sievert. So what is rad and gray and rem and sievert? They are used in biological purposes for measuring the radiation absorbed by a patient or the radioactivity of the source used, like that. So the radiation dose absorbed by a person is measured using conventional unit rad and SI unit gray. So rad is a conventional unit and gray is a SI unit. And about rem and sievert, the biological risk of exposure to the radiation is measured using conventional unit rem and SI unit sievert. So conventional unit is rem and SI unit is sievert. So they are used in biological purpose, as I already said. They're not much important, but just for your information, I included that also in the slide. So this is all about my topic. Now I pass over the presentation to my friend Akhia Sebastian for the further discussion. Thank you all.
So we have come across the units of measuring radioactivity. Is that all enough to measure it? Not really, isn't it? We need certain instruments to help us measure them. So now I'm here to introduce some of those instruments which are used for measuring radioactivity. Actually, there are many different varieties of instruments and methodologies to measure them. And it is not possible for us to go deeper to each and every single instrument. So I wish to introduce the three most prominently used instruments out of them. They are the Geiger-Müller counter, the sodium iodide scintillation detector, and the liquid scintillation detector. So, we will be taking a good look at the instruments, their features, and a brief about their working. So, moving on to the first one, the Geiger-Müller counter. If we take a sharp look at the name of the instrument, we could see that it is a combination of two words, Geiger and Müller, the inventors of Geiger-Müller counter. Hans Wilhelm Geiger was a German physicist and a teacher at the University of Kiel, and Walther Müller was a student. Together, they paved the way to the invention of Geiger-Müller counter. So, this is the schematic representation of the Geiger-Müller counter. And the instrument is something like a tube connected to a detector. The tube is basically filled with an inert gas at low pressure to which a high voltage is applied. Due to the ionization effect, the gas inside the tube becomes conductive and thus it is detected as an electrical pulse. This device is mainly used to detect the gamma rays, X-rays, alpha and beta particles. Another advantage of this instrument is that it is a portable detector. Hence, you could carry it to anywhere you like. It is much cheap when compared to the other instruments. But the main drawback of this instrument is that it is not effective for measuring low energy gamma emitters. These are the various forms of Geiger-Müller counter that have been used so far. As you could see towards the right bottom of the slide, the image represents the Geiger-Müller counter of the early ages. Next, we move on to the sodium iodide scintillation detector. As the name suggests, the main compound used here in this instrument is a sodium iodide crystal. This instrument is capable of detecting low energy gamma radiations. Like Geiger-Müller counter, the sodium iodide scintillation detector is also a portable device. Hence, you could carry it to places you like. They can detect radiations of emitters like chromium-51 or iodine-131. But the main drawback of this device or instrument is that it is inefficient to detect beta emitters like hydrogen-3 or carbon-14. So if we look up at the working of this instrument, when radiation strikes the scintillator, it causes to give off photons of visible light. And these photons pass through the sodium iodide crystal and then strikes a metal foil known as the photocathode. That becomes the first part of the device. And next, the light enters to the second part of this device, that is the photomultiplier tube. When the photons hit the photocathode, electrons eject from the photocathode and they move to the photomultiplier tube. The photomultiplier tube has several metal cups arranged inside it, each with a specific voltage. Now the electron gets accelerated on striking the metal cups and knocks losing electrons on each strike. So, towards the end of the tube, the initial signal gets multiplied by a million factor and is detected by a detector attached towards the end of the device. These are the different types of sodium iodide scintillation detectors used so far. Next, we have the third and the final instrument for measuring radioactivity, that is the liquid scintillation detector. This instrument is really different from the other two instruments. This liquid scintillation detector is a fixed one, which cannot be carried to places like the other two. It is used to detect low energy beta emitters and alpha and beta particles. Here, the device uses a liquid scintillator like zinc sulfide to measure the radioactivity. So the active material is allowed to react with the liquid scintillator, and this allows an intimate contact of the active material. Thus, the resultant photon emission is counted. That is how measuring happens in this instrument. So these are the various varieties of liquid scintillation detectors, which seem to be much huge in size when compared to the other two instruments. But it becomes the most efficient counting system to be practiced. So with this, I come to the end of my topic. I hope that the concept of instrument is clear to all. There are many other instruments to measure radioactivity, but we have only discussed three of them. Thank you for listening patiently to my session. Next, I would like to welcome my dear friend Marin Martin to present her topic and continue with the presentation.
So far, we have heard our friends speak on the principal procedure and devices of measuring radioactivity. Now let's see why it is important to measure radioactivity of substances. The radiation emitted by radioactive substances can cause ionization. When they pass through the human body, they cause damage to living tissues and even destroy them. We are exposed to radiation every day through different means. They include natural radioactivity in air, radioactive materials released from stone, soil and building materials, from medical procedures, mainly X-rays, food we eat, cosmic radiation, and from electronic gadgets. We associate the term radioactive with hazard, but let me bring to your attention that bananas are radioactive. Another fun fact is that there are many more radioactive substances that we consume and we are still alive. The top 10 most radioactive foods as listed by Focus magazine are Brazil nuts, butter beans, bananas, potatoes, carrots, red meat, avocados, beer, water, and peanut butter. Radioactivity of all are here measured in picocuries per kilogram. Let's look at the radiation exposure caused by some medical procedures. Take a look at this table shown. The CT of abdomen and pelvis gives us an exposure of 10 millisieverts, spine X-ray 1.5 millisieverts, hand and foot X-ray 0.001 millisieverts, HCT 2 millisieverts, spine CT 6 millisieverts, chest CT 7 millisieverts, and a PET scan 25 millisieverts. As we can see, the highest exposure is from a PET scan. As far as we understood, we are exposed to radiation daily, one way or another. So how much radiation does human body can withstand? An exposure of 20 millisieverts is considered normal, and above that may cause severe health issues for humans. Before moving on to this table, we have to have a rough understanding of certain parameters depicted here. Absorbed dose is the amount of energy deposited by radiation in a mass. Equivalent dose is calculated for individual organs. It is based on the absorbed dose to an organ, adjusted to account for the effectiveness of the type of radiation. It is used to assess how much biological damage is expected from the absorbed dose. Effective dose is calculated for the whole body. It is the addition of equivalent doses to all organs, each adjusted to account for the sensitivity of the organ to radiation. It is used to assess the potential for long-term effects that might occur in the future. When radiation limits exceeds this dosage, we may have health problems. The primary symptoms of radiation exposure are nausea and vomiting. Overexposure can cause cancer, thyroid nodular disease, parathyroid adenoma, cataracts, brain and CNS tumors. Harvard Health recommends to avoid frequent unwanted scans and thereby exposing to radiation, and also to keep a track of X-ray history. Now we are very clear about the fact that measuring and monitoring radioactivity is essential to determine the dosage administered for medical purposes, to determine the possible life threats a person exposed to radiation may suffer, and decide on the course of treatment, to maintain safety of workers in nuclear power plants, and for effective evacuation during a scenario of nuclear explosion. So in short, measuring radiation is important for the safety and health of human beings. The guiding principle of radiation safety is ALARA. ALARA stands for as low as reasonably achievable. This principle means that even if it is a small dose, if receiving that dose has no direct benefit, you should try to avoid it. To do this, you can use three basic protective measures in radiation safety. That is time, distance, and shielding. Time simply refers to the amount of time you spend near a radioactive source. Minimize your time near a radioactive source to only what it takes to get the job done. If you are in an area where radiation levels are elevated, complete your work as quickly as possible and then leave the area. There is no reason to spend more time around it than necessary. Distance refers to how close you are to a radioactive source. Maximize your distance from a radioactive source as much as you can. To shield yourself from radiation source, you need to put something between you and the radiation source. The most effective shielding will depend on what kind of radiation the source is emitting. While alpha particles can be blocked with a thin sheet of paper, beta particles with plastic, gamma requires a few inches of lead or other dense substances. Now, a question. Does smoking of cigarettes cause radiation exposure? The answer is yes. According to Radiation Measurement and Elimination Services, smoking 1.5 packs of cigarette per day can cause radiation dose of 8000 mrem or 80 millisieverts in areas of bifurcation of bronchial epithelium, which is equivalent to 300 X-ray films of chest per year. So guys, smoking, as we all know, is very injurious to health, so don't do it. Now, our friend Arvind has a very interesting story on the city of Chernobyl. Let's lend our ears to that. Thank you.
Good evening to all. As you can see from your screens, I am going to talk on this infamous incident. Yes, the Chernobyl accident, which we all might have come across at some point of time. See, this is the place where it actually occurred, and it was in the April 1986 that the incident took place, and the area which is now considered as the Chernobyl exclusion zone is in Pripyat, Ukraine. The Chernobyl accident in 1986 was the result of a flawed reactor design that was operated with inadequately trained personnel. The resulting steam explosion and fires released at least 5% of the radioactive reactor core into the environment, with the deposition of radioactive materials in many parts of Europe. Two Chernobyl plant workers died due to the explosion on the night of the accident, and a further 28 people died within a few weeks as a result of acute radiation syndrome. The United Nations Scientific Committee on the Effects of Atomic Radiation has concluded that, apart from some 6,500 thyroid cancers resulting in 15 fatalities, there is no evidence of a major public health impact attributable to radiation exposure 20 years after the incident. Some 3,50,000 people were evacuated as a result of the accident, but resettlement of areas from which people were relocated is ongoing. And this is a representation of the RBMK reactor, which actually exploded. And it was a reactor number 4, which actually exploded on that day. The April 1986 disaster at Chernobyl nuclear power plant in Ukraine was a product of a flawed Soviet reactor design coupled with serious mistakes made by the plant operators. It was a direct consequence of the Cold War isolation and the resulting lack of any safety culture. The Chernobyl disaster was a unique event and the only accident in the history of commercial nuclear power where radiation-related fatalities occurred. The design of the reactor is unique, and in that respect, the accident is thus of little relevance to the rest of the nuclear industry outside the then Eastern Bloc. However, it led to major changes in safety culture and in industry cooperation, particularly between East and West before the end of the Soviet Union. Former President Gorbachev said that the Chernobyl accident was a more important factor in the fall of the Soviet Union than Perestroika, his program of liberal reform. Before we move on, I would like to ask a question. If any of you can name one radioactive substance which was released from the Chernobyl plant. So we'll move on. So as you can see, these are the substances which was released from the radioactive disaster and the Chernobyl accident. And you can see iodine-131, cesium-137, strontium-90 and plutonium-241. So next topic we want to be discussing is about radioactive isotopes. And basically radioactive isotopes or radioisotopes are species of the same chemical element with different masses. Nuclear are unstable and they dissipate excess energy by spontaneously emitting radiation in the form of alpha, beta and gamma rays. Then we can give a particular example as hydrogen, which has three isotopes, and its third isotope, that is tritium, is a radioactive isotope. So then we'll move on to the uses of radioisotopes, and we can find that radioisotopes are used in wide variety of fields. So first we'll deal with the medical application. Radioactive isotopes have numerous medical applications, diagnosing and treating illnesses and diseases. One example of diagnostic application is the using iodine-131 to test for thyroid activity. The thyroid gland in the neck is one of the few places in the body with a significant concentration of iodine. To evaluate thyroid activity, a measured dose of iodine-131 is administered to a patient, and the next day a scanner is used to measure the amount of radioactivity in the thyroid gland. The amount of radioactive iodine that collects there is directly related to the activity of the thyroid, allowing trained physicians to diagnose both hyperthyroidism and hypothyroidism. So, very little radioactive material is needed in these diagnostic techniques because the radiation emitted is so easy to detect. However, therapeutic application usually require much larger doses because the purpose is to preferentially kill diseased tissues. For example, if a thyroid tumor were detected, a much larger infusion, thousands of rem, as opposed to diagnostic dose of less than 40 rem of iodine-131 could help destroy the tumor cells. Similarly, radioactive strontium is used to not only detect but also ease the pain in bone cancers. As you can see, iodine-131 was also a radioactive substance which was released in the Chernobyl disaster, and here it is being used in the medical field as well. So we can see the range of its use. And these are some significantly occurring, naturally occurring radioactive isotopes. As you can see, we can the radioactive isotope tritium, hydrogen's isotope, has a half-life of 12.32 years. And these are some of the elements as well as their half-lives. So before we go on to the conclusion, I would like to discuss about the traces, how radioactive isotopes are also used as traces, and which is being also discussed by a few other groups. So radioactive isotopes generally, as we have discussed, have a variety of applications, and they are useful because either we can detect the radioactivity or we can use the energy they release. Radioactive isotopes are effective tracers because the radioactivity is easy to detect. A tracer is a substance that can be used to follow the pathway of that substance through some structure. For instance, leaks in underground water pipes can be discovered by running some tritium containing water through the pipes and then using a giga counter to locate any radioactive tritium subsequently present in the ground around the pipes. Tracers can also be used to follow the steps of a complex chemical reaction. After incorporating radioactive atoms into reactant molecules, scientists can track where the atoms go by following the radioactivity. One excellent example of this is the use of carbon-14 to determine the steps involved in photosynthesis in plants. We know these steps because researchers followed the progress of carbon-14 throughout the process. In the end, companies and governments claim that nuclear power generation is extremely safe. Incidents like the one in Chernobyl and other parts of the world is a testimony to the fact that even the slightest of mistakes can cause the greatest of tragedies. So with that, we've come to the end of our presentation, and I hope we were able to give you all a brief idea on the following topics: principle of measuring radioactivity, units of measurement, instruments for measurement, uses of measuring radioactivity, nuclear accident at Chernobyl, and radioactive isotopes. On behalf of all the group members, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Professor Dr. Pius Augustine, the physics department, and all my fellow batchmates for giving us this great opportunity. And I hope we were able to do justice to the topics mentioned above.